Underneath that waterfall, nobody else ever saw. I packed up everything except those memories that only I can see and can't get rid of.
Jabronis, welcome back. Well, like I said, we're going to have a guest, and we have a guest. He's sitting right next to us. This man needs very little introduction. You may know him as C. Bumbus, Mr. Olympia.
The Thavage.
The Thavage. I'm sitting here listening to myself, like, live back in my earphones for the first time with my lisp coming through, and I'm like, this is awesome. This is a great start.
Yeah. Yeah, you guys know him. I don't know if you guys actually listened to the second podcast, but he's a person who I take pictures of him when he's like half naked or working in the gym.
Never the gym. Quite fully naked.
No context
Never
behind
quite
that.
Fully naked. Don't worry. C-Bum OnlyFans coming soon, boys. Don't sleep on it.
I'm already subscribed.
Yeah.
But yeah, welcome, Chris. How do you feel to be in BC? I've been trying to get you to come here for like the past 2 years.
It's been probably 4 years, to be honest. It's been a long time. Feels good to be here, though. I'm very happy to be out of my city, which is still on lockdown, and like come somewhere that's much more beautiful and more open and more free.
Facts.
Yeah. This podcast is a little dramatic to start right now, I'm not going to lie. Ours is like a little mic, and this is like a huge soundboard, a camera, listening to myself, everything going on. So it's intense, but the product will be good, I believe.
But that's just kind of me jumping the gun and just buying everything at the same time, too. So
part
of me is just me being impulsive, so...
Word.
If you're going to do something, do it right.
So, where was I going to go here? Do you remember how we were talking in the last podcast, how my ADD is so bad?
It's terrible.
Have you ever noticed it, Chris?
He's all over the place.
Dude, it's like, when I watched that last podcast,
you get that every
so
time, like, you talk to somebody. Like, anytime.
Anyways, guys, we're going to be talking about... Okay, first of all, everyone always asks Chris that fucking one. Yo, dude, what do you fucking eat? What do you fucking train? Oh my God, fucking how does it feel to be Mr. Olympia Classic Physique? Do you get fucking tired of those questions or like, are they?
I mean, someone's talking to me in person, no. Like, I just appreciate that someone gives a fuck to talk about me.
True.
And then if I see it online and constant, I just ignore it.
Dude, I think Matt has said this before and like just like a lot of your other close friends. I don't think me personally could ever just like live in that limelight. I don't think I have the patience, to be completely honest. You know me too. I do not have the patience
maybe,
to do that.
Maybe not you, but it's different when you're not like, you're not a real celebrity, you know?
True.
Like if I go to the gym in West Coast Iron, a few people know me, but like when I'm at home walking around or at my gym, no one knows who the fuck I am.
Yeah, that's
so
true.
Like it's not really like
I think you kind of ran into that too, like a little bit, like, cause you, obviously where you live, it's a little bit more conservative. So you don't run into those people as much,
mm-hmm.
But then when you came here, it was probably a little bit of a shocker. Well, not a shocker, but like, it was just like, oh, because you, the last time you traveled was like back when?
April, end of April, probably.
Yeah. So it's been like solid, like 5 months since you've like had any, like, I guess, interaction with like a fan base.
Pretty much. Yeah.
So it probably kind of felt nice in a way though, right?
For sure. I mean, I never hate it when people come up to me. Like, I genuinely have the attitude where, like, one day I'm going to walk into a gym, no one's going to fucking look at me. I'm going to be an old man, and I'm going to be like, fuck, I miss those days, you know? So anyone who wants to come up to me now, I'm literally fired up for it. If you want a picture, take a picture. If you want to ask anything, go for it. And, like, kind of it lifts my spirits. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
You're true. Pretty active online, too. Like, you respond to people's comments and stuff. Like, when you, obviously, you get lots of them, but, like, when you can, like, you're pretty active.
I actively try to, for sure. It definitely, sometimes you're on your phone too much or whatever, and it's just like, hey, fuck, I need to shut it off. But I do try to when I can, yeah.
Which is pretty sick, because, like, a lot of people, like, in your position just kind of, like, blow off a lot of, like, you know, social media stuff, which is cool that you can still be engaged in that, sure. You know?
Yeah. I mean, people give a fuck about you. You kind of, like, be grateful for
yeah,
it.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, literally.
Yeah.
Were you kind of like, obviously when the pandemic happened, you were kind of a little bit, how did you feel like when the Olympia got pushed back? Were you more relieved or were you kind of just like, all right, I get some more time to kind of just like have a better off season?
I was definitely relieved. I was.
You were, cause you'd be like full and prep, like, wait, no, the Olympia would be happening like
it's
a month from now, right? No, it's in September. So
it's July, 2 months,
but you would be starting your prep right now.
I'd be mid prep-ish right now, yeah, for sure. And I wasn't feeling like I was ready. I didn't have a good off season yet. I wasn't like just feeling motivated. I wasn't excited for it at all. And then everything got canceled, and I wasn't like at a good point where I was like losing anything. So I was like, oh fuck, thank God, like give me more time to get my shit together.
Yeah, fair
and
enough.
That was perfect. Yeah.
So this was kind of like one of the best things that could have happened. You
like,
know?
Literally, if COVID could have happened at any point in my life, this is probably the best time for me to be quarantined. So that's how I'm looking at it.
Dude, you haven't had a fucking, I mean, I've been there for well, besides 2017, I've been there for most of them. But you haven't had a smooth prep off season or on season yet.
No, doesn't exist.
So this is kind of nice, though.
For sure. To be fair, most bodybuilders, when they get to high levels, you never really have any smooth preps. It's not just me. But yeah, it's been nice to have a bit of a breather for sure.
Yeah, true. You're probably gonna be able to like definitely like key into your have a better off season. Well, given that gyms are not open at all, but you still drive to that gym that you were telling me in Gatineau, right? Mm-hmm. It's like 40-minute drive.
40-45 minutes. Yeah, yeah. It's not that
obviously fast. when because you were working out with Ian in the base in a, like a basement gym. Mm-hmm. When you first worked on the real gym, probably hit way different, right?
Oh my god, man! It was weird. Like it was a gym I'd never been to too, and it's more bodybuilding than. Like the good lifes I go to, if people know what that is,
yeah,
have a lot of local of listeners course. Probably. But like going to like a real kind of bodybuilding gym after being in a basement, I felt so good.
Yeah.
Like the week of training was better than training I'd had in like 8 months.
Yeah.
So I was really fired up about that. Yeah.
Dude, I remember when I first worked out at a real gym. Like I was working out my uncle's basement. Dude, were you still working out at Neil's garage?
So? Bro, I worked out there like. Maybe twice.
And you just had free weights.
Twice. Yeah, dude. Okay, I basically just stopped working out in general. I was like, all right, I'm going to take up a career in running.
Dude, you were like 225, right?
I was like 220.
How much do you weigh right now?
Like 210, maybe.
Bro, I almost weigh as much as him.
It's like atrophied muscle, body fat.
When you
walked
in, I was like, fuck, this guy's pretty big. Like, I didn't know what to expect.
I mean, for the first time here.
I didn't even show you pictures of
him. This guy's pretty jacked. Like, that you might be close to Calvin, but I mean, you got some size on him, it looks like.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Nick's always been bigger than me. Because when we competed together at Night of Champions, what weight class were you in?
I was light heavyweights.
Light heavyweight.
You guys competed against each other?
No, I was in class. We had the same coach, though.
Yeah.
So
Billy Dan.
But we prepped. How long? Bro, we had a long prep. It was like 20 weeks, right?
It was
Have you ever prepped that long? No, probably not, right?
Yeah, I've done longer. I've done multiple shows throughout a year that have ended up being longer than that.
Was that before you were pro? I don't think when you were pro, you prepped longer than 20 weeks.
Well, when the first year I went to the Olympia, I did 3 shows that year. And I had like a 2-3 weeks off in between Toronto Pro and the Olympia, but then I was really prepping for like 6 months almost.
Yeah, jeez.
That's so brutal.
Our prep felt like it was a year, dude. Like when we started.
Bro, I know.
Was your first time?
It was both our first.
Yeah. bro.
Dude, I have pictures so of me. Yo, I'm gonna,
you were pretty fat.
I'm going to throw up a picture right now of how fat I fucking was. Bro, I look like a fucking.
I want to see this picture.
Dude,
right now.
Okay. I'll
Show
don't want to.
After, yeah.
It, dude, I look like right now I kind of feel like a bag of milk, but that I look like fucking like.
You were Michelin man status.
I was
it was pretty rough.
The muffin man was coming up on the belly, bro. Like it was, holy shit. Like I had moves and shit, bro. But the thing is with me, every time I don't know if it's like an insecurity, but every time I like gain weight, I'm just like, oh, bro, I'm going to get stronger. Don't worry.
Just convince yourself it's for strength. Again.
Yeah,
I'm a powerlifter.
I'm bulky, dude.
Bro, creatine, bro. But yeah, no, I think it was like when we hit like, I want to say for me, it was when we hit 8 weeks out, that's when shit started to like kind of like fucking float, like fly by.
Like, you know? Like the timeline?
For me, at least for my prep.
I think for me, like the last like 4 or 5 weeks, time just like was gone.
Yeah. The peak week, I didn't even like, it was like a blur to me at least. But
yeah,
I know I don't know how I felt about you, but like when you were prepping, like when I was with you in Ottawa. From my perspective watching you, it felt like I was with you for like 4 months, dude. It felt so long.
When I reflect back and I'm like, wow, Calvin filmed like 3 months of my prep, and I was like, wait, that was 2 weeks, wasn't it?
Yeah, literally. Like,
that's so
crazy.
It
felt
crazy.
So long.
It did.
But I think part of it was because I was working at like obviously working, like trying to get like that consistent flow of like videos out, which I don't know if you noticed at all when I was with you. I was getting pretty fucking worn out. Like San Diego, I was fucking.
By San Diego, I noticed.
Yeah like, dude, like I remember and fucking poor Matt, man. I don't know if Matt's gonna watch it, but I'm sorry, Matt. But like, I remember we were in the backyard of like Airbnb, and he was like telling us to like, yo, bring your camera and take a picture. I'm like, dude, I don't.
Dude. I'm over it. I'm retiring.
So, now I kind of feel bad because all he wanted was just like an innocent picture. And then I'm just like, you know what? It's a fucking picture, man. Just don't stop being a fucking pussy.
I remember telling you, I'm like, yo, just like stop recording everything. Just record little bits and just throw it together. And you're like, no, I can't do that.
You know what?
He doesn't want to miss a beat, dude. Yeah, like, he's got to get everything.
You can get 2 minutes of the day and make that 2 minutes of the video.
Yeah,
you record 10 hours and then edit it all for
spend 10 hours looking through all the footage.
Yeah, I don't know. I think part of me was like, when I was in that process of like film you, I just like, I couldn't, I was so just used to holding the camera and I just couldn't put it down. So I literally just filmed, dude, I think it was around Vegas. Like I filmed a lot. I filmed like every fucking minute that was with Chris pretty much. But that was because like, I think you said it in your podcast. By the way, guys, Chris has a podcast as well, Paradise on Fire, with his lovely, lovely sister, Melissa. I love you if you're watching this. Matt.
Better watch yourself. Her boyfriend's bigger
check
than me.
Check yourself for your
I fucking know. Just fucking Ian's.
You could eat
Ian.
Just call him boyfriend.
Dude, I'm husband. The size of his fucking ankle. Like, he's, yeah. Anyways. Matt, also shout out to them. They have a podcast talking about, bro, you fucking cried your second podcast. Haven't fucking done that. We haven't gotten there yet. I thought
we're gonna get
there. Our second podcast, we were talking about our most embarrassing dates.
So. Yeah, it's gonna get more scenty. It's gonna get way
should
more
start light and ease into it. But
yeah, you just
out the gate, just really, fucking bawling your eyes out. Hold me, bro.
No intro, just straight fucking crying.
Just tears out the gate.
The podcast is just Chris crying for an hour.
ASMR. But just
listening to his teardrops hit the table.
I don't know. I'm kind of scared to get into like Senti shit right now. You know?
Nah.
Well, like it's not
life,
that,
dude.
Yeah, I guess
we're Senti boys,
we're all fresh out of relationships, bro.
Yeah. Well, I've been out of a relationship, but you guys, you're more fresh.
Fresh are you or not fresh?
It's like over a year. I'm like, I'm way over.
Yeah, I'm like,
you're pretty fresh.
I'm almost a year now. Almost.
Has it been that? Yeah.
Like, no, like 8-9 months, I think. We broke up. Fuck, broke up Christmas.
On Christmas Day?
Yeah, bro.
Did you buy her gifts?
Yeah, I did. Oh, of course. I still gave it to her, too.
I don't know. Back to the store, dude. Keep all my receipts.
The one thing that kind of sucked, I got us, you know, the Scandinavian Spa in Whistler?
Yeah.
So I got us thing there. And I was just like, fuck. But I actually.
You still want to go?
Because it was a gift card, bro. Right? So, yeah. But the thing is, like, I couldn't get it. So it was like so I just had to buy it and then, like, have, like, an electronic gift card kind of a thing. So I just messaged them. I literally just told them, like, yo, like, things really didn't work out between us. Like, is there a chance that we could get a refund? And I got a refund. So they obviously felt bad.
They just felt bad.
Yeah, there's like, they're fuck, the poor boys. Guy, man. Because yeah, I called them. I was, like, so stoked. I'm, like, I literally called them. I was, like, hey, like, this is my first time. Like, I've never been there before. And, like, I heard, like, great things about you. Like, me and my girlfriend want to come up. And, like, I just want to, like, have a good time. Like, good time. That sounds really weird. I'm saying that I'm going to a spa.
I want good time.
But like, I just want to go up, you know, like, and they're just like, oh, okay, you know, you got to go do this. You got to do like the massage and the sauna and the hot tub. And then like, we bring out drinks for you. I'm like, fuck, this is sick, dude. Bro, honestly.
Bro, you should have just gone.
I know. I fucking probably just want to buy my
boat. Dude, I would have gone.
I know. But yeah, I got that.
Get a rub and tug you down there. Tuggies.
Scandinavian tug.
I feel uncomfortable in the Viking tug right now. I don't know what I'm getting myself into.
Yeah, you got
into.
No escape here.
I have no idea. I have no idea what I'm getting into.
Raw and unfiltered Jabroni. But no, like that was about 8 months ago. But we're all pretty fresh. So how many times have I cried since we've broken up? I want to say 3.
Add a zero to that.
30? Could you imagine?
Just a quick shower cry. Those are my favorite, dude. I love those.
Shower cries?
Bro, you just get in there and you just let the water run down your face.
You don't even notice. You're just like, it's just my face and you just feel like cold water. Oh, it feels good.
You can get the ugly cries too because you can get like all the snot and everything running and just let it all just come down your face. And just
like, I feel like I always have a cry in the shower after I compete. Not always, but a lot of times.
Yeah, that's
just
definitely
like,
a good spot.
Get off stage, everyone's around you, they're congratulating, everyone's like, so, there's so much, and then you get in the shower, and you're just alone. And you just feel everything, like, everything you went through, that prep, it's all just
done. Fucking tan running down his face.
Yeah, I just won the Olympia or something, and it's just like, when it should rush it out of you in the shower, you know?
That's a good place to let it all go.
Yeah, true. Most of my times, I think, probably were in the car. Because, I don't know what it is.
You're always driving, too.
Well, like, the thing is like, she was super into, my ex was super into Billie Eilish. And, bro, her songs are, like, sad. Sad. Yeah. So, like, I'd be coming, driving back from, like, West Coast or, like, work or something. And I'd be listening to Billie Eilish, and I'm just like...
just make yourself more upset.
Yeah, literally just making, because like her tone's like so low and it's just like super sad. I'm just like,
it's very monotone, it's dark, bro.
It
right?
is dark as fuck. Yeah. So I'm just like, yeah, no.
Bro, I would.
So most of my cries have been in the car, 100%.
Bro, whenever I'd have like a car cry, I'd like turn up like some Juice WRLD and like, I had these lucid dreams.
This Dude. Is why you guys are best friends, eh?
Literally. Hold on, I just need okay. Just make sure you're. We're all fucking wearing black, boys.
We planned this out.
I looked at the footage last time, and the black did not do very well because it made it. But it's
right
okay.
on the backdrop.
It's okay.
Right?
It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. But yeah, fresh out of relationships. We're definitely not competing. I'm not competing again. You definitely aren't. Nope. You have to, so you don't have a choice.
I'm stuck in this bullshit.
You're locked in.
You're locked in for life. But I think one of the things that. I mean, and this was kind of the topic that we were going to talk. Sorry, we didn't fucking see. This is what happens when you have good boys just having a conversation. It just goes off in other directions. That's how a podcast.
Or when your mind is working on anything.
I mean, yeah, true. I should probably, dude. I'm starting to consider maybe I should just start taking more CBD so my mind's not running at 6,000 miles a minute.
Bro, your last brain cell is just firing on all cylinders.
It's just like fucking it's just bouncing going. Around. But anyways, this podcast, we were kind of just going to talk about like our careers and like where we came from where we started and just like, you know, like how we came up to where we are. Like, so I think a lot of, for me, if you guys don't mind, I'll go first because I'm probably going to talk.
You were going to go first anyway.
Yeah. We all knew you were. Just take the wheel.
Thanks guys. But, I guess I started back really, everything kind of took off when I met Chris, really. We met at a bodybuilding show. I already told the story, so I'll be very brief, but we met at, a bodybuilding show that you were guest posing at. And I think from there, I kind of just like, I literally just went up to Chris and was like, oh dude, you remember me? You remembered me, right?
No. When
I
can't. Not at all.
He held on to that pride too. He's like, you remembered who I was.
All right, guys. I'm just
gonna definitely told you I did.
Wow, dude.
I feel bad when people are like, hey man, do you remember me? And I met like 500 people in a day. I'm like, yeah,
do you at least fucking remember the day?
You're that guy.
Do you at least remember the day I came up to you at the Olympia when you were like,
I remember you showing me the picture 2 years later.
Wow, you fuck. Holy shit, scummus. Mr. Olympia's a scum, boys. Stay away from him. I'm just kidding.
I mean, damn, like, dude, that was pretty hard. An hour, and then you're one of them, and then it's hard to remember, you know?
Well, you obviously remember when I made you the video.
Oh, you followed me around and stalked me. It's hard to forget that.
Yeah,
you just shoved the camera in his face. And you're just
literally that's what something. I did. And that's literally like, I was just like, I think I just came up to him and was like, yo, what do you like, YouTube? Do you do YouTube? And you're just like, yeah, I'm kind of. I was like, can I make you a video? And you're just like, yeah, I guess. So I just literally just sat next to him.
Literally probably how the conversation went. Yeah, I guess you could. Sure.
No, literally. That's literally how it started off with. And then I just pointed the camera in his face and I was eating a donut in front of him. I was kind of a dick. So.
Pretty sure I had one.
Yeah, I think you had like a little one.
I wasn't dead.
Yeah, from there I worked in the BC AVA, which now is the CPA. I don't even want to get into that. But I think a lot of my content career actually started when I met Chris. Like that's when I really dove right into it. And for me, the best part, I think it was this year that kind of had like a little bit of a wow moment. And that's kind of how this podcast came. I was working at Dodge originally and then I got let go from it. And I was just like, yo, dude. And then COVID happened. And I think honestly, like dead ass, every person through this whole like quarantine has like had a little bit of time of like self-reflection. I think everyone has.
Hopefully.
I mean, you're kind of forced into it.
Yeah, so like, you're just like sitting at home, like either you're playing Warzone or you're just staring at the ceiling crying.
I was in the gulag a lot though. Yeah.
So. Fucking rest in peace, boys. But I'm kind of fast tracking, but like I was doing content creation for like here and there, like doing mini shoots and stuff like that. But I really kind of this year was me. I like kind of took it by the wings and just like went off with it. And I remember Nick and you were always like, they were like, all my close friends were always nagging me like, dude, you need to do this full time. And like we were saying in the last podcast, like sometimes it takes more than just hearing it to be able to pull the trigger and actually do it. You just got to experience certain things. Like you got to do a lot of shit that you're not supposed to do in order to be doing the right thing.
It's the learning curve.
Yeah. And then it was just like, ever since then, like as soon as I got let go, I'm just like, yo, dude, fucking, I literally texted Chris and I was just like, dude, I lost my job. And I'm like, when am I going to come out to you? Cause I was just like, so eager.
I don't even think you said that.
I
said something too. I was like, well, maybe this is time for you to go back to your dream or something fucking cheesy like that. And
yeah.
Jerked you.
Yeah. And pretty much. But for me, like, and not to like be a kiss ass to you, but like, honestly, I owe a lot of like where I've came from and like my content and like being a content creator and like a creator has a lot of it has come from you, because like, if it wasn't for me meeting you, I don't know where I would be right now. Like not facts.
I think you still would have found your way. It might have just been a different, maybe longer path.
But. Yeah, but here's the thing, like, and this is one thing that I know, like, off the from my perspective at least, is like, you were already going to be you're gonna always be on the scale of just like growing in the first place. Like from when I first met you, you had like what 200,000-300,000 followers, 400.
No idea.
Something small.
I don't know.
Well, that's still big. That small. Yeah, it's not small, but like at the time, it was like you were like literally like, as soon as you competed in the next year, you just fucking like literally got like 500,000 followers after Olympia, and then I think it was this year you broke 1 million, right? Yeah. Something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But like, so like for me, I don't think I like you were already going. You were kind of already on your path, just being like an influencer and like or already. From at least from not trying to like sound biased, but like you were already going to do well in bodybuilding to begin with. I've just been like able to be in your presence and be able to create content for you. And I don't think my content has significantly made your social platform like any bigger. I think
my YouTube a lot. I would not have documented nearly as much as my document prep, yeah, or whatever at all. I know you've forced the camera into my face. There's a lot of times where I would vlog one day or want to, and I'd be like, fuck that. Like, I feel like shit, fuck this bullshit. I'd like throw my camera. I'm like, I'm not touching this. And if Calvin wasn't there, he just came up and threw it in my face, and I was like, fuck you. And he would just stand there and force it on me, which is exactly what I needed. And I'm so grateful I have all that footage you took. Yeah. But I think there's a lot of my prep I wouldn't have documented. And that's like a big part of what grew my YouTube following and people seeing such a story told through my prep, which was from you.
Yeah, true. I think on the YouTube side of things, that definitely helped a lot. But I think for more of like, it was more just like, I don't know, I don't want to say it was by luck, but you know, obviously I'm a huge believer that things happen for a certain reason. You meet certain people in your life, but I think it was, if it was not for that day that I just came up to you, like the awkward little Asian kid that I was, and I was like, hi, Christopher, can I fucking film a vlog for you? And like, now that I look at it, I tell Nick, and every time I look at that first vlog I made you, I just look at it and I just want to throw up because it was so trash in my eyes.
I'm going to repost it.
Dude, please do not. It was, the edit right was so bad. The footage, but I didn't even know how to fucking like, I didn't even know what lenses were back then. I was just like.
you learned know? Though, man.
Yeah, but no, like, I think eventually down the line, like if I weren't to have run into you, you probably would have ran into another content creator. Not to say like that, like, you know.
I mean, but I haven't since.
Yeah. Well, I mean, thanks.
And I'm pretty picky of fucking who true. I would allow in my fucking live with me during a prep.
Yeah.
I don't think there would. I don't know anyone else. Matt's the only other person who probably would have, and he's not a content creator.
And we haven't really stepped on each other's toes. Well, besides me chewing your ear, I'm which I don't know why. I'm surprised
this guy hasn't pissed you off to the point of you like throwing him out. There were a few times
I got pissed, but never threw him out. Just maybe raise my voice a little bit.
Well, like, I know, like, you hate the way that I chew, which is okay, whatever. And
the way you drink. Every time you take a drink, you go.
Yes, yeah, dude. Like yes, that. He does, dude.
When I'm driving too, like you need to like be in everything. You need to be close. You need to stick your head in it. So I'd be driving. It would be like me in court in the front seat. You'd be in the back. You'd slide into the middle, lean forward between the two of us like a little dog, and then he would take his monster and be like crack open the right in my ear. I'm like, Calvin, if you don't get the fuck away from my ear right now, I'm gonna kill you. Or he's sniffling like.
You can't blame
my sniffling. Like, I just have bad allergies.
It's just one extra little cherry on top.
Yeah, I'm 100%. I was in prep extremely impatient and just very irritable, and it just got to me. But it was it was stupid little things like that. Yeah. It was never a big thing.
I don't think I've ever pissed off Nick with just my stupidity, though. You've kind of just, you've just become numb to it.
I've deflected it. Like, I'm kind of immune to it, to be honest. Yeah, that's
true. But
you just kind of have to accept that with being your friend.
Yeah.
I can deflect it.
You're going to get in there.
Apparently, I'm just a fucking absolute shit show to be friends with. So, but that's okay. You need a fucking, you need a Calvin in your life once.
You do.
Yeah. You need someone to entertain you once in a while or piss you the fuck off. You need a happy, you need a medium balance, bro.
You do.
You need someone that just like just drives you nuts. Rather than you should just look at him like, look at this psychopath.
If people only knew.
If people only knew. But no, man, like, yeah, I think it, like, I like 100% grateful for like all the trips that we've been on. Like, it's been fucking dope, man. And like, I think that's one of the things that like kind of showed me, like, just being able to like, wow, I can really like, I remember, bro, remember like in Popeyes, like I would talk to you like, man, I can't wait. Like, what if one day, like, I end up, like, you know, what if I worked for, like, a Gymshark athlete? Like, this is back in, like, 2015. I remember you were
super hyped over Gymshark, yeah.
Like, remember we were, like, helping promote the Popeyes Fall Classic? I'm like, dude, how sick would it be if one day, like, you know, I was affiliated with Gymshark somehow. Not, like, working for them, but, like, I was around them and, like, I was, like, going to events with, like, by a third party or something. And then, like, literally, like, 2017 hit and that, like, well, you weren't signed with Gymshark right away. You were with...
Until 2018, yeah.
Yeah, 2018. And then, like, literally, like, I think our first trip that it was, like, it was Sydney, right?
Was it?
With me and you together.
It might have been.
Australia, I think so.
Yeah.
That was pretty life-changing for me. Like, even after Sydney, when I came back home, like, even on our flight, I was just... I went back home and I was just like, holy shit. Like, I just, like... That was, like, really one of my dreams. Like just I wanted to, like... fly the world with someone that is affiliated with Gymshark and just like make vlogs and just like have a good time. And then like, I think that's one of the things that in quarantine, like I just like sat back and like, damn, like I've actually done some pretty dope shit that like I can from this point right now, like if I were to like, if like I could look back and be like, damn, I'm pretty like happy with what I've done so far with content creation. Like obviously I have more goals in mind that I want to do, like shoot for bigger companies, like, you know, and get on production level. But like, I can't complain with the shit that I've done so far. And thanks, buddy.
Proud, but never satisfied.
Yeah. Wow. Plug for a company that I probably shouldn't name since you're affiliated with another.
You can name whatever you want.
Okay. But no, it's been one hell of a journey, dude.
Been a good time.
Want to come, right?
Yeah. Right. Hell yeah. Let's hope so.
I mean,
we got another prep coming up soon.
True. Once this travel ban shit's over with. But no, I've been, I think working with Nick at Popeyes, like that was like when our passion for like fitness really ignited, you know, like we were so like, it like, dude, like every day we were in Popeyes, man, we were just like so like invested in just like fitness.
We were active, like, man. We were in it, dude.
Yeah. And I know, like, because like at that time, like around that time, like you're kind of wishy-washy if you wanted to stay in the industry too. Like you were at one point, you were unsure if you want to be a personal trainer, right?
Yeah, I was actually looking into it.
Does that ever cross your mind at all again?
Nope. No?
I mean, nope. Obviously what you do, like, and I told this Chris this too, that you work in the same house as my brother. It's just so weird how that becomes a coincidence.
I know.
Like, how is that a coincidence?
Like, how does that happen?
Yeah.
I'm
pretty sure your job in itself right now is pretty damn rewarding. Like, when you wake up and you go to your job, like, what is the most rewarding thing to you? Like, what do you love the most about it?
I mean, like, there's a lot of stuff that I love about it. Like, I mean, probably the biggest thing is... like I'm able to help and contribute to people who aren't able to, you know, go out and do things that we just take for granted. Like, yeah. I can go out to the gym, or I can go out to the swimming pool, I can go to the movie theater, I can go anywhere without somebody, you know, watching over me. And, you know, for somebody who can't go out into the community safely, or they can't go out on their own and they need somebody to help them just to do their day-to-day tasks, like, that's a pretty incredible thing to be able to, you know, to influence somebody's life to that level and just help them have a better quality of life. I think that for me is probably the standout, like, highlight. That's the biggest thing that I
take away. You were always a person that loved helping out people, especially, I know, like, when we worked at Popeyes, like, every time, like you had a customer and like someone was asking you about like, and they were a newbie, you I remember there's been times you'd spend like an hour with one customer.
Well, like, I got invested nice in some though, right? I know, but like some of those people too, like you get so invested into a conversation, and like I've had so many conversations where I would just talk about like somebody would come in for a fat burner and they're like just very overweight, mm-hmm. and they just want the quick pill, the easy fix. Yeah. And you spend like an hour, 2 hours talking to them about like diet and how to, you know, train properly, exercise, all the like key stuff, and they're just like, okay, sick.
What pill?
But give me the fat burner. Yeah. And I'm just like, fuck, one, man.
Before we continue, I think you need to fix your fucking stand. It's like yeeting off the table.
Get outed for something.
Okay, I have a question for you about your job. Have you found a significant difference since, compared like before and after doing your job helping people, like you said, in your own gratitude and appreciation for your regular day-to-day life? Like you said, you brought up, you can go do whatever you want all the mm-hmm. time. Have you actively noticed that like when you go do things now, you're like, holy, you're more grateful for it?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. Like I have a lot more appreciation for just like, and I mean, I've kind of always been that kind of person mm-hmm. where like I've kind of been like a glass half full type of guy. Like, you know, trying to keep in mind, like, you know, if I was living in another country, like a third world country or something, like, you know, they might not even have running water or whatever, right? Like, I've got the luxury of doing anything that I want, really, right? And it's like, obviously you have like your moments where you get down, but it's like, man, it's, there's so much to appreciate. Mm-hmm. Like, there's just so much good shit that we can do that I've got available to me that I can't really stay down for too long.
You have a very positive perspective on the world you live in.
It's
definitely helped though.
Mm-hmm.
When you work with people that just don't have that opportunity, I think that's one of the biggest things why like I'm now just so passionate about everything that I do, is because like, you know, I look at my brother and then like, you know, there's certain things that he can't do, right? And then like mm-hmm. I see him when he comes here and he just like has a bowl of like chicken nuggets and he's like the happiest kid in the world. And then I'm over here complaining about fucking, you know, my shoe size wrong, or I didn't get the right fucking camera lens, or like, you know, my fucking computer crashed when I was editing and shit like that. And it just makes me think back like, okay, hold on, like relax. Like shit could be way worse, you know?
100%.
I know that sounds so cliche for everyone to say like, you know, relax, you know, people, you know, mm-hmm. like I know that cliche, you know,
kids are starving somewhere else,
you know, but it's like,
I mean, I think perspective is a big thing a lot of people lose in our world right now.
Yeah.
Like a 100%. Lot, especially with social media and all the highlight reels and everyone people follow. People think real life is what they see on social media and how people portray themselves. Everyone wants to be perfect. So everyone loses perspective. And like the only reason people are unhappy is your mindset. Mm-hmm. It's not what you have or don't have. It's how you perceive what's in front of you.
Yeah. And it's like, I'm pretty sure that job for you has been pretty damn life changing from just like the things you probably learned from just a kid. It's weird how you can think that like you wouldn't think that you would learn from someone that is like, I know it sounds really wrong to say, but you wouldn't think that you would learn from someone that has a disability or something like that. But in reality, they teach you things that like,
they've taught me so many things. Okay. No, I was just going to add to that. Cause it's like one of the biggest takeaways I've got is like patience too. Right. Cause it's like where maybe I'm able to just throw my shoes on and go out the door and go do whatever activity I wanted to do. And there's like, there may be a process behind what somebody else needs to do. Like they need to go through, you know, an entire checklist or something like that. They have, you know, maybe an OCD or something where they have to do something in order to get ready. And getting ready might take me, you know, 30 seconds, might take them like 20 minutes, right? Mm-hmm. So it's like just learning, you know, learning to be more patient on my end, but also watching, like watching some of the things that they're insanely capable of, like, you know, maybe a huge love for art or like just super simple stuff that like we again take for granted, and they've got like just like this huge passion for, right? Yeah. Like I don't know, it's definitely taught me a lot.
Yeah, that's like for sure. Yeah, dudes, and some of those kids, man, like those autistic kids, like they have some skills that I don't even think normal people could ever have. Like there's kids that I know that are like so like fucking good at math, and it's scary. Like you could just tell them like equation and they will like solve it right off the bat. Like a lot of them actually have photographic memory too, which anyone that, first of all, anyone that has photographic memory, like, blast, bro. Like, I wish I had that. You know how much easier my life would be? Yeah, like, I can't, sometimes I can't even fuck, dude, during this podcast, sometimes I don't even know what the fuck we were talking about originally.
So, honestly, yeah.
But, like, it's just crazy to think that, like, you know, you would think that some of these kids, like, have disabilities, but in reality, they don't, man. Like, they live such a good life, you know, there's a lot of people that love them, and, like, they, in their own way, teach you things that a normal person could not teach you. You could listen to all these mentors and, like, whatever, like, all these, you know, high influencers, shout out Chris, but, like, you know, they could say all these things and, like, you know, like, oh, you know, this is how, like, I got to where I am, but, like, at the end of the day, like, none of that stuff really matters, because, like, when you look at the way that they give advice, is because they give advice on the way, like, how to be successful, whereas, like, these kids, they'll show you ways of how to just be more grateful and just, like, appreciate more things in life. And that's, mm-hmm. like, the biggest, I think, flaw of what, that we find in, like, you know, in our society, people our age, you know, they just, like, all it is about now, all it is about today, like we were saying in the last podcast, notches, how, like, how you flex, like, what car you drive, you know, how many, how much Gucci you're rocking.
Always trying to prove something.
Yeah, you always got to try and prove something, right? Like, and that in itself, it just leads down to, like, a, such a lonely world.
Well, because you're never gonna hit that yeah. high, right? Like, yeah. every like, daily life just becomes kind of, like, mundane if you're just chasing the highlight reel, like.
Yeah. For sure.
Do you like? I know for you, from your perspective, like, obviously, there's a lot of people that look up to you. But, like, do you ever have those, you know, I'm sure you probably have a lot of those moments where, like, when you talk to someone, like, all of them, like some of the people that came up to you in the gym today, there was like, oh, dude, like, you know, Chris, such a big fan. But, like, I'm sure you've had your fair share of guests that, like, have, or sorry, not guests, fans that have come up to you like, dude, like, you literally have, like, changed my life. Like, I've done, like, I used to be like this and that. Like, you probably had a handful of those, right?
I've had a few, yeah. And talk about crying, I had a few people come up to me and start crying, telling me a story, and then I start crying, and there's, like, a lineup of, like, people, and I have to turn my back.
I'm like, fuck, wait, guys, I just need a water.
Yeah, but, like, to touch on kind of stuff, a lot of stuff Nick said, like, my bodybuilding and social media stuff is a very selfish sport, and that's why, like I said, I was very grateful when anyone wants to come up and talk to me and stuff, because I like seeing that other side of it, that it's not just me. I'm never doing anything just for me. When people do come up and, like, share me a story, how I've helped them, inspired them, pushed them towards their goals in any way, it's like, holy fuck, like, this is bigger than me. This is really fucking cool.
I think that's one thing that kind of keeps you feeling to keep doing this too, right?
Well, for sure, yeah.
Yeah, like, yeah. I couldn't imagine, like, you know, it's, for me, like, I think you handle it the best out of every influencer, you know, and I think a lot of people just like you for who you are. Like, people, you just show your personality too. I know I sound biased, but you show yourself in the truest light. But I also just force you to, and I just film everything part of your life.
I can't hide it.
You really can't hide anything.
Always.
But I know
the whole day is on film.
What for you? Like, when was that? When was that moment where you were just like, was there ever a moment where you're just like, shit, like, this is my job. Like, I literally am, like, I'm here to just, like. Like, do you ever see it as a job where, like, I'm here to change people's lives, or you're just here, like, as a platform to just influence people, like, in a more motivational way? I know that's a loaded question, but, like,
I don't sit there actively and think I'm changing people's lives.
Yeah.
I'm not like that. And I don't think, like, every time I hear it, I'm almost shocked, mm-hmm. to be honest. And I'm extremely grateful for it, but I'm like, holy fuck, really? Why? Almost, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it almost catches me off guard. Like, that's not the reason I'm kind of doing anything. I'm not doing it to prove anything, or I don't know. But when I hear stuff, I'm definitely shocked, and I don't really even realize what I'm doing most of the time. And I've had a few moments recently, going back to the gym or something, back home, and where people will say something to me, come up to me, and then I'll, like, turn around and be like, holy fuck, this is my job, this is my life right now, and I'll just, like, smile. Yeah. I'll be like, fuck, I have a good life.
Yeah.
And it, like, clicks back into my brain. I'm like, holy shit, this is real.
What would you say are, like, kind of the highlight moments that you've had, like, I guess, in your career, where you're just like, damn, like, this is like a sick moment. Like, besides, like, traveling and all that kind of stuff. Like meeting other people, like, that you've looked up to in a long time. Like, I'm sure there's some people that you look up to that you've met and you're just like, holy shit. Like, I remember that one time that you met Jay
Cutler.
Yeah that was a pretty dope moment.
I'm never someone who's really, like, followed someone so intensely and really looked up to anyone, so to me, none of those moments really stuck deeply with me. It was really cool meeting a lot of these people that I respect a lot, but that was never one. Most of my biggest moments come from competing, because, like, yeah. Again, I don't view myself as an influencer. When people call me that, I'm always like, people will come up to me and be like, you're the Gymshark guy. I'm like, fuck.
I'm the Gymshark guy.
Someone said that to me a month after I won the Olympia, and I'm like, I'm still known as the Gymshark guy when I just won the Olympia. But I don't see myself as like an influencer, you know? Yeah. So a lot of my like moments that I can think of all kind of come from competing usually.
Yeah. It's definitely like, it's yeah, I don't think I could ever just, I'm so like, the thing is like I said at the start of this, I'm so impatient. So like if there was a bunch of people like trying to say hi to me, I would just get pissed off at a point. Just
walk away.
Yeah. Just I mean, even like, I know you were saying in the gym, like this is probably annoying for Calvin, but like honestly, I don't mind taking pictures for people. I feel more bad for you because like, you know, you're trying to be nice and like have a conversation with everyone, but at the same time you gotta like look down at your watch like, okay, I've been here for like an hour talking to people.
It's pretty rare for me to care, but there are some circumstances where people are almost like rude and I can tell they're not like realizing that I'm a real person and I'm here to train too, and they're just like, wow, this is this thing online that's in real life now, and they're just like, hey man, like let me get a picture with you. They won't even say hey, they'll be like, hey, let's take a picture. They'll just say like that to me. Nothing else. Just, hey, hey, take a picture with me. And just like hand the phone to someone and turn and pose for the picture. And I'm like, hello, what's your name? Like,
yeah.
What's going on? Like, do you even know who I am? Or like, did someone just tell you people follow me on Instagram, you know?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Those are kind of like rude people, but like, I just kind of let them fly by. But those are people are pretty rare. Like everyone at the gym today was very like genuinely nice. Like, I really don't want to ruin your workout. I just want to say hi. And then they're like, can I get a picture too? Like politely. I'm like, of course. Like,
welcome to BC. You gotta move here.
You never know.
Vote in a poll if you want Chris to move to BC. Well, he already bought a house in Ottawa, so you just have to sell that first.
Just move it right to do.
Yeah.
True. You can live with Calvin forever.
I mean, my mom literally said you're welcome to stay here as long as you want.
Yeah, your mom keeps offering me food so that I can stay.
By the way, my mom legit renovated this whole entire house before he was coming here. I don't know why. She really did the caulking in my bathroom.
She's trying to get rid of you.
As if Chris was going to look at it like, just, oh, this caulking is...
this is the replacement child coming in.
Yeah, I'm moving back to Ottawa, boys.
We can just switch. Yeah.
Just swap lives.
Just swap.
Looks like you're competing at the Olympia, buddy.
Yeah, I'm going to take you
I'll film you.
No,
I'll
dude.
Film your prep.
Yeah, what is it? The fucking the health and wellness classic physique?
Literally, yeah, there you go.
Whoever has the softest fucking belly wins. But yeah, man, I always look at like from your perspective and like obviously I've been through like a lot of the stuff. Well, not a lot, but like 3 years, 4 years. 3 years, 3 years. Yeah, 3 years. 3 years of the sup, and then, like, I always just look at where you started from, like, just, like, this average kid from, you know, CBBF, got his pro card, just cleaned house, and then just, like, your career kind of passed pretty fast, dude.
It really did. Like, there wasn't, I don't think I've had a year up until this point where I wasn't, like, on to the next step each year.
Yeah.
Like, you're every single time. It was always just going. Next step, over 5 years, and then this year was kind of the end of it.
Yeah, you kind of just like cruised through. You haven't like cruised, sorry, is what I meant to say. You haven't just like cruised and just kind of like taken a step back. You're just like, okay, holy shit, I did so much in 3 years. You know, you've never really had a break because you've been, I think as soon as you signed with Gymshark, that's when you were all over the place, right?
Traveling
a lot. Like 2018 that was year, your yeah. biggest travel year,
I traveled a lot that year, yeah. Probably why I got sick that year. Fucked my body up.
Got COVID.
But... yeah, it's, do you ever just like, I know like you probably haven't just like said this, but like, do you obviously for competing it's not one of those things that's going to be like it's not a lifer for you obviously, right?
No.
Like you just plan to like, I know you don't have a timeline, but it's just something that, you know, you have a title now and you want to obviously retain it. But like moving forward, like there's obviously a few certain things that you want to do. Like attain, like personally, right? And just like kind of slow down, put the brakes on competing. Yeah, put the brakes on competing, maybe focus on other aspects, like I don't know, maybe getting wifed up or like I don't know.
Hey, if I can find a wife while I'm competing, then that's a good wife right there.
That's true. A wife that can cook all of Chris's meals.
I cook all my own meals. What do you mean?
It'd be nicer to have a honey to just be like, honey, I'm cooking your
breakfast. Yeah, but sometimes during prep I'm wanting them so like exactly how I want it that I have to cook. You know, it's also like therapy when I'm starving to cook my own food, kill another 30 minutes and then eat instead of waiting for it.
I feel that.
Dude, your meals are literally just basic and then all you need is sugar-free ketchup. That's literally, then that like makes the cake for
everything.
Until
I get that cut out too. And it's just chicken and rice.
True. We're not going to talk about food and prep though. If you guys want to know more about Chris's training and eating, we're not going to talk about that. You can go download his app, C-Bum Fitness. C-Bum Fitness, right, Nick?
C-Bum Fitness.
C-Bum Fitness. .com. .com, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Still live. Home workouts and shit. Or no, right? Yeah?
We have home workouts.
Do you guys update it daily, weekly?
The home workouts are bi-weekly, but everything else is daily.
Yeah.
If you're looking for something to do,
yeah,
get in shape.
Get huge.
But,
yoked.
Yeah, guys. I guess to kind of wrap things up, what do you kind of like, obviously when the O and everything is, once you do the O and obviously win it again, but like, do you have any plans for yourself, like what you're going to do moving forward? Obviously when the travel bans lift, can probably get back to traveling around a little bit more.
Yeah. I mean, I think traveling is kind of a basic answer, but totally, like you said, competing takes really like everything in, out of your life. Yeah. It's like all my life is, it's like difficult for me to travel. If I do, I need to come somewhere with a home and a kitchen where I can eat, get my meals, I can train. If I'm too long on the road, it's a bad workout. Anything that ruins any kind of routine is bad for competing, and it just stresses you out. Mm-hmm. So especially when I'm competing at my level, it's like I need to just kind of be locked in, and it makes you, it makes me not less ambitious to do everything else in my life, I find, which maybe is very personal to me, and I'm not exactly proud that it makes me less driven to do other shit, but it does. It honestly does. So I definitely have other shit I would like to accomplish in my life other than just competing, especially now that I'm 25 and reached the pinnacle that I could ever reach.
I keep forgetting that you're only a year older than me. Like, fuck.
I'm an old man. You'll feel old at 25.
Fuck with that fucking musty beard, yeah?
Yeah, you're like a big daddy.
Well, both of you have musty beards. Yours is a little bit more tidy.
His is way
bigger. Bro, look at his fade. Look at what happened.
Oh, my God.
It looked like an Elmo haircut.
Oh, fuck. Who did that?
I don't want to.
Don't drop it.
She normally does a really good job. I just asked for a weird haircut, and she kind of fucked it up.
But, yeah. Do you find that also, like, sorry, I know we're ending things, but I just came on top of my head.
I feel like something distracts the answer and then moves on, and then Calvin asks a new question. And we're like, "What's? Where are we going?
Calvin's back and forth.
Your social life has definitely, would you say, has it been...
next topic.
Jesus, Calvin.
What was I gonna say? Oh yeah.
Where are you right now?
I don't know, dude. Like, I was literally thinking
this? I think there's other shit playing with headphones that we can hear.
I know, he's like in his own world over here.
Listening to music.
Dude, you know what we should do in the next podcast?
Shut up. Stop. Go back. Go back.
What? Every time we meet you.
Like, there's like three different areas that you're going here, and like you keep just stopping and moving on to a new one.
It's okay. What was I saying about your social life? Did you ever like miss that, just hanging out with the boys once in a while? Like, you still do, but like not as intensively because you have to put most of your life towards bodybuilding, right?
Sometimes, yeah, for sure. Like, I still get to quite a bit, but when you're prepping, it's a lot less. Mm-hmm. But honestly, like, I like prepping sometimes, and I'm like so excited to compete and get through it. It's all really worth it to me. And I mean, I used to love... When I first started competing, I hated missing out on partying because I used to party a lot back in college.
Fucking just like, ragers,
just bro. Drank just way too much. Just a fucking frat boys. Like, too much partying. And then when I pulled out and started competing and I still lived in Halifax with all my friends in like a frat. It wasn't actually a frat house, but you don't have that in Canada, but they just partied a lot. And I always missed it. Then I was like, fuck, like, I wish I was just boozing with the boys right now, you know?
Boozing with the boys. Fucking all this Canadian go for Ottawa. A fucking right.
But not anymore. It's not so bad.
Yeah.
I have a good balance.
I personally, like, I think that's one of the main reasons why I wouldn't compete again. Part of because I'm just fucking fat now. But
you like, you like Oreos too much. Oreos and Fieldhouse. Oh my God.
I do not fucking touch my Oreos. But like, I think part of me is just, I'm such a social person, and like, you know me, like I need constant like social stimulation. Like, I just like talking to people, and it's fucking like,
I know you're vibrating.
I'm just fucking like, let's fucking talk about life, you know? But I just need to constantly always like be around and just like talking to people, because that's how, like, I'm super extrovert. Yeah. I'm just like, I thrive off of that. I like that energy of just talking to people. I think that's one of the reasons why I don't see myself ever competing again, because I can't isolate myself. Like, I did it, whatever, and I got the job done. But like, looking back at it, I was like, nah, I don't want to go through that again. And I don't know for you if you've ever...
Calvin's friend, are you extrovert or introvert? Are you like that?
I think I'm a little bit more introvert. I'm like socially awkward and weird, but he makes me come out, and like, yeah, he'll literally call me up and he'll be like, yo, are you home? I'm like, yeah. He's like, all right, come outside. I'm like... what the fuck, dude? Okay,
have,
fine.
It's good to have friends like
but
that.
But it's good. It makes you come out of your shell a little bit more. Sure. So
I think, no, I became a lot more social, like, probably, like 2 years ago. Like, I used to kind of be in a shell a little bit because I think that was just because I was going through, like, a little bit of phase where, like, you know, wasn't really sure where I was going with my life and stuff like that, you know, as far as, like, my career and everything like that. And I think after that, like, just a lot of the social skills I've gained through, I think, traveling with Chris and also working at Popeyes, working at Lululemon, like, all that kind of stuff. And, like, mm-hmm. ever since then, I was just, like, I noticed that I work very synergistically, like, with people, and that's where I need to kind of be around, right?
100%.
I mean, the thing is like, that's kind of an issue for me too, because I socialize with everyone. And, like, Chris was actually kind of saying this to me. He's like, dude, you're just, like, fucking everywhere. Like, you're just, like, a fucking bee. You're just, like, and, like, you're socialized with everyone. Like, you have, like, be careful. Like, you know, there's some people that might not be, like, have the best interest as you, as just, like, being a good person, right? Like, mm-hmm. I would like to think that, like, whenever I socialize with someone or I'm interacting with someone, I'm always trying to be in the best interest, like, have a good time, kind of something like that. Yeah,
I feel like at a fault, you, like I was saying to you before, you see this, like, good in people, you just want to be friends with them, you're out there, like, you talk with them, they're a good person, they're my friend. Mm-hmm. Whereas, like, you know, like, sometimes there are people that it's okay not to be friends with because maybe they do shitty things and it's, like, not the kind of person you need, you know?
I think one of the things I kind of realized is, like, and I realized it when people really started noticing that I was, like, your content creator. And that's when a lot of people started talking to me, like, oh my God, like, you're buddies with Chris. And then, like, okay, yeah, cool. And then we talk about it. And then, oh, dude, like, maybe you should go to beer. I'm like, fuck yourself, dude.
Where were you before this?
A girl, he loves it.
Yeah, literally.
Buddy, you want some C Bumbus? I got it for you.
If it's a guy, it's like, fuck you, man. You're talking to me for Chris. If it's a girl, yeah. Did I tell you I live with Chris for 2 weeks?
Hey. Yo, he slept right here.
I saw him in his underwear and I filmed it.
He did.
Literally. But no, like, it in reality though, like, I would, especially even, like, with girls, like, I would much rather meet someone and, like, know what I'm about and who I am rather than just, like, they want to be associated with me because of, like, just someone else that I know. You know what I mean? And that's why, you've been, like, my closest friend for, like, so long. Like, you never, like, you know, I don't think, and no offense to you, but, like, you've never, I don't think I've ever asked me once about, like, Chris or anything like that or anything like that. You've just always been, like, you know, my dude, dude. You've been my dude.
My dude, man. My guy.
You've been my dude.
My guy.
But, no, and, like, I think that's one of my issues is, like, I socialize with too many people and I don't know the good and bad, you know, but I think I've been better at it. I don't know. Maybe I'm fucking terrible at it.
If you're happy, you're not getting fucked over, then who cares?
Oh, maybe I'm low-key getting fucked over. I don't even know about it.
I mean, that's the one thing you got to watch for. That was that's a question for you, though. Like, because, like, obviously, like, being at, like, a celebrity status, like, you probably notice a lot more people coming around you and, like, trying to get into your circle. Like,
bro, there's people that try to copy him, man.
I answer his first.
stay on track.
That threw me off.
Sorry.
I mean, of course, there's going to be a little bit. Like, I would never consider myself a fucking real celebrity, but there are totally people who I can tell come into that. But opposite of Calvin, I'm very introvert. And, like, I sit at home, and my friends that I hang out with are my friends from grade 7.
Yeah.
Like, from 13 years ago, they're still my same friends. I have, like, a party for my buddy's birthday. It's the guy I met when I was 12, you know?
That's pretty sick. Like, those are the
people I hang out with. And then my sister and my brother-in-law and my parents.
His thunder buddies. Yeah.
And then Calvin's and Matt are, like, the only two friends that have come into me in this industry and stuck around. Come into me. Woohoo! Easy! Come into my life. And stuck around
because
I genuinely believed and felt that they were, like,
good
my
people.
Friend for who I was as a person and not what I had achieved or what I had done or anything. So,
right.
Yeah.
God, sorry, I was still laughing at that.
Such a fucking child.
Let that go. But yeah, I don't let people into my life very often. So.
That's, yeah, I guess that definitely comes in handy in mm-hmm. a sense because, like, I would imagine that a lot of people would try to just kind of, like, chase clout, you know? Like, try to just gravitate around you mm-hmm. and the fact that you're, you know, more introverted is pretty sick that you've got, like, the same old school friends and, you know, you can differentiate the people mm-hmm. that are coming around you for, you know, trying to help you or trying to just, you know, just be like a good, you know, a good solid friend and not just mm-hmm. somebody who's gonna leech off you.
Definitely helped me stay very grounded and, like, who I am, staying true to who I am as a person, because people treat me for who I am.
Yeah.
You know, like, because that's all they've ever known me for. Sometimes they forget I'm a fucking bodybuilder, you know? which I love being around people like that.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
It's refreshing, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Were a lot of your friends at Melissa's wedding?
Not a whole lot, no. Oh,
okay, but I mean, just from, like, I would assume that, like, you guys kind of hang around the same crowd, but, like, you know, when I see those people that, like, you hang out with, like, you can tell, you know, they're genuinely just, like, good fucking boys, you know, that just fucking sometimes you take it to the basketball court and fucking, you know, just have play ball or just, like, sip on a few Ronas and shit like that, you know?
It's nice Rona
to have
season.
Those, nice to have those friends rather than just fucking... constantly just asking about, like, yo, what was your prep, dude? Like, fucking,
yo, can you send me a new workout plan, bro?
Yo, so, like, what's the Gymshark gossip? Does blah 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 actually hate blah blah blah?
And I'm
like,
dude, what?
I don't know.
I couldn't imagine how much you get that. Like, dude, is this true? Like, this happened? Like, this, can you tell me about it? Like, fuck yourself, dude.
And I'm like the least involved person in any of that stuff. I'm like, I have no idea even who you're talking about.
Chris has a hard time just fucking remembering that he needs to wear matching socks, so he wouldn't know a lot about that. That's so true.
A simple man,
but simple man. Anyways, guys. Thank you for tuning in. I forgot to fucking set up the outro song. It's okay. Okay.
So you're going to say you forgot to press record. I think.
Holy no, shit. I think. That would be shit. We're almost. Look at that, boys.
I know.
We're
I kept on looking at it. Don't worry. I got you.
I literally have 2 minutes to pick a song right now. Okay. Perfect.
Stunning.
I'm not playing.
Come on. This is the guest song here, wow. Man. Come on. You're
listening.
Oh,
at home,
shit. First of all, we're listening on the wrong thing. It's supposed to be played on here. Stunning. Who is that even by?
I have no idea.
What's your favorite type of. What kind of music do you listen to at the gym? Wow, my mind really is all over the place.
Yeah, we only have a minute, so you better find your song.
Oh shit. What's your favorite stuff to listen to in the gym?
Between some like kind of heavy rock if I'm having a big workout or EDM, bro.
What were you listening to in the car? I don't know what that was, but it was hitting hard. The beats were hard.
Lewis the Child.
Lewis the Child?
Yeah.
It
sounds sick.
I think it's like a band or a DJ or something. I don't even know what they are, but they have a lot of like stunning songs by who? Some are like DJ, some are like singing, and it's like a big variety.
Stunning by who?
Stunnin.
Stunnin?
Oh shit, get rid of that G. Oh, there it is.
Okay, well, I was forced by nature. I feel like this is gonna be a trash song.
It's an awful song.
Well,
I just wanted you to play really
there you guys
song.
Have it. We have literally 30 seconds to make this outro, but thank you for tuning in to this third episode with our first guest ever, Mr. Chris Bumstead.
C-Bum.
Thank you guys for having me.
And we will see you guys in the next podcast.
Very nice. I spot the dick when she wanted.